He's got air. He's got gas. He's on fire.
He's on fire.
Carburetors. What's up? Welcome back to the Garage Science Edition. As you could tell from my carefully worded intro, we are talking about carburetors. Nowadays, carbs get kind of a bad rap. But don't listen to your friends that hate on carbs. You know, those friends with their fancy fuel injectors, or their Atkins South Beach diets, or the friends that have gone keto, or the friends that tell you you don't understand the concept of homonyms.
Words.
Carbs are awesome! If you're anything like me, first of all, you like ponies and puppies, and second of all, you wake up in the morning asking yourself, self, how do carburetors work? And then you ask yourself, self, why doesn't anybody like me? What's the point of life? Where'd all this blood come from? To understand carburetors, we need to understand air and gas. And to understand gas, we gotta talk about my butt. And sorry, gang, my talking butt show is only on YouTube Red. Wink. I say wink because I can't actually wink. Now, we need to look at how air and fuel mix to feed fire. When oxygen's combined with a fuel, it begins oxidation. And when that happens rapidly, it produces light and heat or fire, and we call that combustion. That reaction needs to be fed oxygen to continue growing or to keep burning at all. When there's forest fires and the wind kicks up, the fire grows. Those old tiny steam locomotives, when they needed more power, besides shoveling more coal into the fire, they'd also open up all the vents under the coal fire to get more free air inside to make it hotter. You cover fire with water or some other chemical, you're keeping it from getting oxygen, so it extinguishes and goes out. Fire can't survive without oxygen. That's why if you're ever in a fight with the Human Torch, your best bet's to try and somehow lure him into outer space. Right now, you're probably like, yeah, Bart, we know. Fire's cool. What about carburetors? Okay, give me a second, I'm getting to it. Different materials and liquids have different burn qualities. Pretty early on, they found out that gas burns easily.
Holy!
We covered in our gasoline episode why it made sense for engines to be powered by it. Because we need an excuse to light some gas on fire, let's do it under the guise of a PSA about why you shouldn't leave rags lying around your garage. Hey Bart, can I get a hand? Not a problem, Bart. How you doing? Bart, that's a pretty cool shirt. Oh, you think so? Yeah, I got it on shop.donut.media. You subscribe? Absolutely I subscribe. That's how I know they're coming out with new merchandise every week.
All right.
All right, good luck with the experiment, Bart. Nice shirt. Whoop! Hot dog! Oh, sorry, Matt, he's my boss. So the vapor from the gas traveled down to the flame. That's why carburetors are so good, because gas vaporizes easily. And it's also why you don't leave rags around your garage. I hope you guys learned your lesson. That was for you. I don't do this because I want to. I do it because I want to keep you safe. But liquid gas alone isn't enough to provide the combustion needed in the engine. You need gas mixed with oxygen. And that is what the carburetor does. Great job, Mr. Carburetor.
Thanks, Bart.
Hey, you know my name.
I'll tell you where the blood came from, Bart. You're not gonna like it.
Okay, we'll talk after the show, Mr. Carburetor. The air gasoline mixing done in a carburetor is done kind of the same way as how my mixing's done in this badass cooling mister. See, when I pull the trigger, it pumps the air, pulling the liquid, collecting little drops of it, and forcing it out of the opening in the nozzle and into my face, keeping me nice and cool and moist. Wink. Or I can take a cup of water and put a straw in it, and then take this air hose that you can find outside of any gas station or maybe your home, and blow air across the top of the straw. Water is gonna get pulled up through the straw and sprayed out as a mist. And that's because of Bernoulli's principle. Remember from aerodynamics, you'll know Bernoulli's principle states that an increase in the speed of a fluid occurs simultaneously with a decrease in pressure. So what we're doing is we're creating lower pressure above the straw than around the outside of the water. That is gonna pull the water up and shoot it out. That's pretty cool! The carb needs to make sure that enough air is mixed with the gasoline so all of the gas burns during combustion. If you're not mixing enough air, you're not gonna get an effective burn from all the gas. Sometimes, if it's too rich, it's not gonna burn at all. Now I'm gonna do something dumb to show you what happens if we've got too much gas and not enough air. Well, we got gray shirts now too? Absolutely, they got all kinds of stuff. I'm telling you, man, you gotta sign up at shop.donut.media. You get updates whenever they have new stuff. Just to prove how much our combustion reaction needs air, we know there's too much gas in here. It expanded so much it forced all the air out. And to prove it, I'm gonna very stupidly drop this candle into this jug. There's not enough air in the tank to burn. Just this little bit up top's burning the gas. So if a carburetor is shooting too much gasoline in there, it's not gonna have enough air to do an efficient combustion reaction. That was pretty neat, even though there wasn't an explosion. The optimum ratio of air to fuel for a typical combustion engine is about 14.7 pounds of air for every pound of gasoline. Carburetors vary in design and complexity, but the simplest one is essentially a large vertical air pipe above the engine cylinders with a horizontal fuel pipe joined into one of the sides. And as the air flows through the pipe, it passes through a narrow kink in the middle, making it speed up, causing the pressure to fall. And that kinked section is called a venturi. The falling pressure of the air creates a sucking effect that draws air in through the fuel pipe that draws fuel in through the pipe at the side. So the airflow pulls in fuel, but the air-fuel mixture still needs to be adjusted. The carburetor's got two swiveling valves above and below the venturi. At the top, there's a valve called the choke that regulates how much air can flow in. If the choke's closed, less air flows down through the pipe. It chokes it. The venturi sucks in more fuel, so the engine gets a fuel-rich mixture.
One for you, one for me.
You want that for when the engine's cold and you're first starting up. Beneath the venturi, there's a second valve called the throttle. The more the throttle's open, the more air flows through the carburetor and the more fuel it drags in from the pipe to the side. With more fuel and air flowing in, the engine releases more energy and makes more power, making the car go faster. Opening the throttle makes the car accelerate. It's like blowing on a campfire. The throttle's connected to the accelerator pedal in your car or to the handlebar in a motorcycle. The fuel inlet to a carburetor is a little more complicated. Attached to the fuel pipe, there's a kind of mini fuel tank called a float feed chamber. It's a little tank with a float and a valve inside it. So far, it's not too complicated. As the chamber feeds the fuel to the carburetor, the fuel level sinks and the float falls with it. When the float drops below a certain level, it opens a valve allowing fuel into the chamber to refill it from the main gas tank. Once the chamber's full, the float rises, closes the valve, and the fuel feed switches off again. Kind of works like the water tank of your toilet. You know, when you take the lid off and you look inside, the tank water empties when you flush, but then refills to the exact right amount and then stops because of the float. Huh, guess my car and my toilet have a lot more in common than just pooping in both of them. These days, you're not gonna find a lot of carburetors. The only real reason to get one is if you're trying to rebuild an old muscle car to spec, or you need your classic hot rod to have just the right look. Almost all modern vehicles have switched to fuel injected systems. Here's the reason. Fuel injection is a much more efficient, much better way to get power because you're mixing the gas at the point of combustion. But carburetors are a whole lot easier to work on and they're a lot cheaper as an entire system. A lot of motorcycles still have carbs, but even there, high performance designs have all made the fuel injection switch. Fuel injection in most cases just winds up having higher power output, greater fuel efficiency, and much lower emissions. The only real drawback to fuel injection is that it's a lot more complicated and expensive to install and maintain. The 1991 Jeep Grand Wagoneer was the last American production vehicle built with a carburetor. Rest in peace. Carburetors! Thanks so much for watching, guys. Subscribe to Donut. You may have noticed I was wearing a bunch of different shirts. That's because we've got so much merch. You know what had carburetors? A bunch of these cool cop cars. If you like thinking about air fuel mixes, you can check out this video on superchargers. Follow Donut on Twitter and Instagram at Donut Media. Follow me at Bids Bardo. Don't tell my wife I was using her tweeters to tune my carburetor.